Good morning, all of you out there in streaming Northgate land. It is a pleasure to be seen by you today and to have this time with you to share the love and grace of God and maybe a word or two that you might find encouragement for the challenges that you face not only this past week, but the week yet to come. And Lord knows we have had some challenges here of late. But things seem to be moving in a positive direction. And hopefully soon we will be able to come together once again face to face. But until then, we will enjoy our time together at this designated time. It kind of reminds me of the old Batman show that when I was a kid that was on television. It's the same bat time, same bat channel, same bat place. So we're here at the right time to enjoy this time together. I want to bring you up to date what continues to happen in the life of your church. And for those of you who are joining us as guests, I want you to understand that Northgate is active. As the hands and feet of Christ, we continue to be involved with the community in some way, shape, or form. And one of those that we do each Saturday is our food pantry. And I want to commend you for those of you who are members of Northgate for your not only financial contributions, but the fact that you are ordering a little extra each week in your groceries when you can and getting those here to us here at the church so we can help those that are in need. This week, one of our wonderful and beautiful benefactors, Dr. Marie Morris, who is a retired Irving ISD teacher, I believe, at the time. She was kind enough to come by this week. She comes about every 2 weeks or so. This week she brought some bread and other vegetables, staple vegetables that we can use. We have a good connection with Bear Creek Baptist Church, which is over here just on the other side of town off of Rochelle. And the connection that we have with them is that occasionally they provide us with boxes of produce, which they were able to do that this past week, and we were able to give out about 10, 11 boxes of produce, fresh produce, to those who came seeking help this past Saturday. Also, one of our own members, along with the help from his good running buddy right now, Theodore put in a garden back here in the back of the church where the old storage building was, the one that kind of leaned and slanted this way that was taken down. And that spot has been used to put in a garden. And we've had a harvest a couple of times come out of that. And out of that, we were able to also put about 10 to 12 bags of fresh vegetables with peppers and tomatoes and whatnot into resealable bags to add with the boxes that we gave folks this week. So I want to thank Theodore for his willingness to do that hard work of tilling the ground and getting everything planted, and along with he and William, and I believe Cecil has been out there as well to help cultivate that garden, and it is now producing for us. This past week, we served 10 families, 61 people in total, 40 of those being adults and 20 of them being children. And like I said before, we're finding that our adult numbers are higher, not only for the fact that we're including the teenagers in the adult section because they tend to eat a little more than just children, but also we have found that because people are out of work, have been furloughed, actually laid off, some businesses have closed down, that we're finding more adults that are in need of help as far as food is concerned during this time. So we are thankful And you should be excited about what you're able to do and how we're able to help one another. This is what our call is. This is what we're supposed to be. We're to love God, love others, and make disciples. So we continue that work that has been set before us. I want to make this part of the announcement time. We have a special treat next week. So you might want to tell a friend or definitely be available next week. We're going to have a musical guest. We have what I believe is called the first row or number one trumpeter from the Las Colinas Symphony Orchestra. Nathan Little will be joining us in this time stream next Sunday and is going to use his beautiful gift that God has given him to enlighten us and joyfully lift our spirits. So please join in with us next week as we have this wonderful presentation on behalf of the Las Colinas Symphony Orchestra. That is all the announcements that I have for you this week. So that, with that being said, I'd like to pause for a moment. Ask you to take that deep cleansing breath to relax your mind, to get focus for the standpoint of where we move from here as we begin our worship time together. As Valerie leads us in our call to worship. Valerie.
Good morning again, Northgate family, friends, and guests. Please join me in today's call to worship. Over the turbulent waves in our lives, Jesus calls us.
We get so busy watching the waves, we block out Jesus' call.
Look again. Jesus is calling to you.
Lord, help us hear your voice.
Come, place your trust in Jesus.
Lord, forgive our doubts, receive our lives.
Amen. Please bow with me for our opening prayer. Lord, you know us too well. You know how easy it is for us to come to you and to proclaim loudly of our faith when all is going well. But when the waters get rough and the waves threaten to swamp our little boats, we cry and wail in fear. We are sure that these waves will be the very thing that destroy us. Over the wind and the waves, you call to us to place our trust in you. That's not so easy for us. We are so used to getting lots of reassurances and written guarantees of safety. But still, you call to us. Help us take our focus off the wind and the waves and place our gaze directly on you. Attune our hearts and our lives to hear your call and to respond in faith. For we offer this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all. cup of blessing which we bless. And we, the many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Many the gifts, many the works, one in the one bread, one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, the many, throughout the earth. We are one body in this one Lord. Grain for the fields, scattered and grown, gathered to one for all, one bread. One body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, the many, throughout the earth. We are one body in this one Lord.
It's this time that we come to remember that we are a connective body. And by being that connective body, we are with this one Lord. So when we lift up prayers for one another, those prayers go to God. And however God chooses to move within our requests, it is done on our behalf. So we're at a time in which we come and remember those who are sick and shut in, and maybe have had some challenges in life that just need a little extra something. And we can lift those prayers up on not only their behalf, but our behalf as well. If you have copied down the bulletin, printed it out, or you will see it as we're streaming it, of those names that we continue to have in our prayer and concern list from the concerns of the community, and we have a number of names that have been there for some time. So if you are aware of some names that we might be able to remove because of the circumstances have changed, please be sure to give the office a call and let us know. But as I have my time with you each week, there are times that you reveal to me some things that you would like the community to lift up on your behalf. And I have a few of those for you today. We want to lift up Gail Tatro and family, because Gail let me know on Friday that her sister Kay has entered into hospice, and she is at a nursing home there in Round Rock. And the challenging thing concerning this, more so than her being in hospice, is for the fact that all of us know during this time of COVID, we are being restricted as to being able to be with loved ones and see family that are either in nursing homes, living centers, hospitals, and whatever. And so Gail was very concerned about whether or not she was going to be able to travel to Round Rock and be able to see her sister during this time. So we want to remember Gail, Tatro, and family as they deal with this time of her sister entering hospice and the need to try to be connected as family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I also got information this morning that Pat Swan, who is a past member or present member, but she hasn't been active in a number of years, that she completed her earthly life on yesterday, and that we need to keep that family in prayer as well. We do not have details at this time about any of the arrangements of what's going to take place, but Pat Swing, who is a member of Northgate for a number of years, has completed her earthly journey and now rests with the Father. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. We have some news for Rick. A number of you know each week I've been giving an update on Rick. Rick is still at the rehab center that he went to after leaving the hospital this last time, but he had a heart doctor visit this past week, and his report was good. Things were improving. He's still there at the center, and there is still work to be done and plans that need to be made in reference to him having to start having insulin shots on a daily basis, but he's got some good news. Things were great with his visit with the heart doctor, and the heart doctor tells him he doesn't need to see him again until October. So for that great news, we are thankful. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Once again, Clyde Hogan is gone missing in action. I haven't been able to get in contact with Clyde since I told you these last 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago, one of the two, that I actually did speak with him and he was at home. And since then, I've tried several times to contact him again. As I made you aware, Clyde had to have his right hand removed because of cancer. And so I'm just concerned that maybe some complications may have come up and he needed to go back, but I have not been able to make contact with him nor his son. So we want to remember Clyde in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I did speak with Barbara Williams this week, and Barbara informs me that her sister and niece, who is her primary caregiver, are doing better as they continue to have their fight with the COVID. They have improved and they're working their way back. And so we ask that you continue to keep them in prayer as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In speaking with Jessica each week for the Orth family, she informed me that her mother, Mindy, has a cousin who has had a stroke and would like for the family of the cousin and them, the Orth family, to be kept in prayer as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Connie and Mary informed me in our conversation this week that there's a relative in California that the family, and not only Connie and Mary, are in need of prayer because of this time. And so we want to uphold Connie and Mary Smith and the extended family in California during this time. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Valerie is going to, a number of you have asked and been wanting to know about Valerie. You notice that she has not been up on the platform with me these last 4 to 5 weeks, but Valerie is going to have her knee surgery done on this coming Friday. So we want to definitely lift up prayers for that, for not only the relief of the pain that she does experience at various points of the day, and that it does everything that needs to be done, and quick healing for her. I guess getting your knee on is not minor surgery. And anytime someone is getting cut on, it's not minor when it's not you. So prayers for Valerie as we go to this next step on Friday. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. And lastly, great news. A number of you are aware that Natasha Burks had been working diligently to finish up her college degree, and that has taken place. And so she is now a college graduate. So it had been challenging for her, and the fact that having 6 kids at home and all of them in school at some point, whether it be from preschool all the way up to being now, I believe he's either a sophomore or a junior in high school, all the different work that had to be done with those under her roof, but also having to do her own work. So this great joy is one that she is proud of. She says it's still kind of anticlimactic because she received her diploma in the mail, and normally you get to walk across the stage and there's all the hoopla and everything to take place, and that is not happening this year because of COVID. So she says, yeah, it's complete and it's done, but she says it kind of seems like it just really hadn't happened yet because of the situation. She's hoping to be able to do some type of celebration in the months to come, but we want to lift up Natasha for that journey that she has been on and that achievement for being able to receive her college degree. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Would you go with me now in the spirit of prayer? Gracious and glorious God, we thank you once again for not only this day, but this time that we have together. You have heard the prayers lifted up, dear Lord. There has been loss. There has been joy. There has been good report. And there are challenges. And as we all face them during this uncertain time, and the fact that our children will be returning to school, some right away, some in weeks to come, but the new way of educating our children and them being able to find the help and what is needed during this time. There are some who are not going to be able to function real well on their own at home, trying to do it online and not have the teacher readily at hand to help guide them through. But Lord, we ask that you look down upon all of them, not only the students, but the teachers as well. And that our leaders who are not only leading the school, but our state and our nation and our world can truly find that if they would just trust in you, that if they would call on you, that we might have all and exactly what we need. for those that are in the hospitals, the nursing homes, the rehab centers, for those who are yet still at home and recovering. We ask for your blessings. We ask for your touch, that healing touch, whether it be for the mind, the body, or the soul. Gracious and loving God, once before you gave us your Son, that we might have a better and closer connection with you, may we as your children remember to use that connection, to trust in you, to be loving and forgiving, and help in any way that we can. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. David.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Thank you, David. We come to a time to affirm our faith once again. And again, we will use this heartwarming Apostles' Creed. And you should have that before you at this time, either in your bulletin or there on the streaming screen. So would you go with me now as we remember and say our affirmation of faith? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. David.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows His will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
This morning's scripture reading comes from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 through 33. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me!" Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. Are we sinking because we took our eyes off Jesus? Let me share this lead-in for you. A little girl who was blind was caught in a fire on the 10th floor of her apartment complex. But because she knew the layout of the apartment so well, and even knew where her room was in the darkness, she was able to make her way to the other side of the apartment through the heavy smoke to the window that was facing the street. She could not see anything, and oh, she could smell all the smoke. Then she heard a fireman say, "Jump! Jump! Jump!" The little girl yelled back, "I'm scared to jump. I can't see." The fireman yelled back, "If you don't jump, you're going to die. Take a risk and jump." It's bad enough that she was going to have to jump from the 10th floor. But then to be jumping and not being able to see where you were jumping to because you're blind. Jumping was terrible under that situation. But in the midst of the chaos, of all the noise and confusion, all of a sudden, she heard a familiar voice. The father had pushed close to the line, and he stood next to the fireman, and he said, "Darling, jump. I've got you." And the little girl smiled and said, "Okay, Daddy, I'll jump." Jesus Christ is inviting us to jump. He knows that you're nervous, but jump. He knows that you're scared, but jump. Remember, we're talking about the one who is in lockstep with our daddy. We're talking about someone who knows you, and you have seen what he can do. Would you go with me in the spirit of prayer? Lord, enlighten what is dark in me. Strengthen what's weak in me. Mend what's broken in me. Bind what is bruised in me. Heal what is sick in me. And lastly, revive whatever peace in love has died in me. Amen. Now, let's have a little review. Jesus had wanted to get away. He was already at home trying to relax from his last road trip and needed to decompress and relax before going back out on the road again. But he had gotten this horrible news that his cousin, John the Baptist, had been killed. So now we pick up at the end where we left off on last Sunday, in the fact that he had wanted this time alone, and he wanted to just be able to have that time to pray and console himself, because not only had he lost a loved one, but he had lost also a fellow journeyman who was helping with the news, the good news about what was taking place. He needed the time. And instead, he found out that in his place of solitude, he had to continue ministering to more than 5,000, teaching and healing. Plus, he pulled off the world's greatest fish fry and fed all those folks. To me, that wasn't getting away for himself. So we pick up at verse 22 in chapter 14, and it says, immediately the disciples had moved from a scene of miraculous provision from God to a terrible encounter. Yet notice that the circumstances that were brought to them in fear were under God's sovereign control. Jesus had made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him. They were in God's perfect will and was about to enter a perfect storm. And we find that, like those disciples, by being obedient to God, sometimes leads us into some rough and stormy sailing. Nevertheless, we can only be reached by his love and by the divine permission that God has in store for us. As we move into verses 22 through 24, we find that the boat is far from shore and that they were being battered by the waves and wind, and because the storm was up against them. Where was Jesus? Well, remember, he was trying to get that alone time. He was doing that Southwest Airlines commercial bit. He had needed to get away. But in the midst of him going up to the mountain to pray by himself, Jesus was not absent from them. He wasn't unmindful of their needs. Let that sink in for a moment. He wasn't unmindful of their needs, nor is he unmindful of our needs. Jesus intercedes for those who are being challenged. His full-time job is to serve as an intercessor between us and God. And he is perfect for that, because not only does he understand God, but he understands us as well. In the midst of the disciples' stress, as we begin to hear in 25 through 27, Jesus came towards them walking on the water. He came to them in a very unexpected way, so they can understand and experience him like never before. Jesus would once again demonstrate the divine authority over the world. When the disciples started to panic and thinking he was a ghost, he comforted them with words before he addressed their circumstances. As our opening story went this morning, once the little girl heard her father called out, she began to calm down and be ready to focus on what needed to be done. Jesus comforted them with words by letting them know that it was he. And so, with all that they had been going through, all that they had seen before, how he had addressed things, even though the waves continued to batter the boat and the wind continued to howl, to some extent, maybe they started to calm down a bit. Peter, who did something that nobody else in the world probably would have done. He asked Jesus, "Can I join you on the water?" Peter didn't want to just be protected. He wanted to experience something with Jesus that he would not ever be able to experience in his life. And with that, Jesus invited Peter to step out on the water. And Peter boldly stepped out because he was focused right in on Jesus. He had his eye on him, trying to make sure he stayed where he needed to be. But the more steps that he made, the more he took, Peter, sometimes being human and just like us, maybe began to think about, look what I can do. I'm walking on water. And as he's walking and maybe feeling real good about himself, there's this big bolt of lightning comes across and hits probably behind Jesus, shaking Peter's resolve. Again, he feels the waters slashing up against him as he's walking. He feels the wind blowing in his face, his hair moving all around. He hears the thunder roll. And in the midst of that moment, those moments, those challenges before him, he lost his focus and began to sink. Does this sound something like us? When we sometimes get maybe a little too big for our britches, as the old folks used to say. Storms in our lives do come, and sometimes they are raging. Things are not going well at work. One that you love doesn't seem to love you anymore. You're in school as a young child and you're being bullied. The baby is sick and needs to go to the doctor or the hospital, and you're not in a position to truly go and do what is needed. You're a young person in high school or maybe fresh out of school, and you want to be a part of the in crowd. But the in crowd that you're wanting to be in with is not one that maybe you should be traveling. And it's disconcerting to you because they're the ones that you want to be with. They look like they have it all going and got it together. But you know your parents would not approve. And because of that foundation that's been laid, that you're building upon, you also find yourself uncomfortable with the idea of going on forward to try to be a part of that in crowd. It doesn't match up with who you are and what your parents would want you to do. Are we sinking because we have taken our eyes off Jesus? So, like Peter, if we're smart, we will call out for help. And Jesus, being who he is, reaches out and gives us a hand. And just like the anthem that David so beautifully sang today, love lifted me. Love lifted me. when nothing else or anyone else could help, love lifted me. And like Peter, we are rescued and pulled into the boat, and we began to see those storms around us begin to subside. And too, like Peter and the other disciples, we worship him and declare and know that truly he is the Son of God. With every new encounter, Jesus is increasingly in our understanding, asking us to depend not only upon him, but the experiences that he has had and that he is relaying to us. By God's grace, we have been given the opportunity to go through those fearful circumstances, to come to know Jesus in a deeper and closer relationship and worship him. He is the sovereign Son of God, who exercises power over all things and wants you to discover that the bigger your fears, the more powerful he is. And he invites you to keep your eyes stayed on him. And when we do, we find that we can travel through any storm that comes in our lives. And the people of God said, Amen. I hope that there was something there that spoke to you, that you realize and know that even in this uncertain time of COVID, the lost jobs, the furloughs, the change in jobs, the sickness, whether it be a light touch of it, or even those who have had some deep intrusions of COVID in their lives and have spent anywhere from 5 and 6 and some 3 times 3 months, 6 weeks, 3 months into the hospital dealing with this. As the uncertainty goes with how our economy is going and whether or not we're going to get the needed help that we need from our leadership. But I want to remind you, I hope that you can see from our lesson this morning that in the midst of these storms, there is one who can direct and guide us through our storms. And because of our following, because we are children of God and followers of Christ, we, the collective body, will help each other during our times of need. So I want you to be blessed. I want you to stay encouraged. And I want you during these times that we are getting some relaxation in the standpoint of the rules and yet still be safe, to let people know that they're loved. Because that is what the world truly needs right now, is some love. So may you keep your eyes focused on Jesus, and that at those times when the storm begins to overwhelm you, and you call out for help, that not only will you be that helping hand, but you will reach and take the hand that's offered. As we go away from our live streaming this week, may you know of God's grace, may you know of his love, and may you receive his forgiveness. Laura?